Welcome to another edition of the NEF Talk. With over 50 of these in the past 10 years, this has now become a pretty well-established format. We call it the three C's: contextualize, converse, and conclude. And today we are very fortunate to have Hans Timmer, World Bank's Chief Economist to South Asia, here with us, and we will be having some conversations around export and beyond, plugging the trading gap in South Asia. As I said, today's format will be some contextualization, then some conversations, and then we will have some interventions from the floor and the closing round. As with all NEF talks, we would ensure that we will have some fun. This edition of the NEF talk would not have been possible without the support of NMB Bank Limited. Thank you very much, NMB Bank. NMB Bank has been operating in the Nepali financial market for the past 23 years and is one of the leading commercial banks in the country. But before we begin, we have some not very good, news about our former advisor and, for me personally, a mentor, Mr. Prabhakar Rana, who, sort of been associated for past three decades. He passed away on 30th of June, and we just thought that we would just have a minute of silence to remember him. So may I request everybody to stand and join in for a minute of silence in the memory of Mr. Prabhakar Rana.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much. He was always a man of action and did not believe in much fanfare or formalities, and we thought this would be a way of providing a fitting tribute to him. And I would just request our advisory board member, Dr. Shankar Sharma, to come and say a few words.
Thank you, Sujibji. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We are really saddened at the passing away of noted industrialist, respectable Prabhakar Samsir Rana. He passed away while undergoing treatment in the United States. Mr. Prabhakar Samsir Rana was the founder and chairman emeritus of Solti Hotel Limited. He was a versatile businessman and was engaged in multiple sectors like tourism, hospitality, trade, hydropower, and automobiles. He founded a couple of dozen industries and services and conducted them very successfully and transparently in Nepal. He was also decorated by a number of national and international medals, decorations, and awards. He was a much respected elder statesman of all the sectors of Nepal. Nepal's top politicians, ambassadors, international politicians who had interest in Nepal used to see him for his advice. He was also the member of the advisory board of the Nepal Economic Forum earlier. Mr. Rana's demise is an irreparable loss to Nepal's industrial as well as tourism and hotel sector. I, on behalf of Nepal Economic Forum and myself, pay a tribute of love and respect to the departed Rana and extend our condolences to the family members. Thank you so much.
May I invite Hans on the stage to start our NEF talk and our conversations? I think I just wanted to just set the stage before we begin, and we'll have Hans speak for about a couple of minutes to just open up the discussion, and then we will go into some conversations. So as I mentioned earlier, Hans took over as the World Bank South Asia Chief Economist on the January 1st, 2019, and he has a 30 years illustrious career across many organizations working on economics and econometrics. Hans.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. First of all, very sorry with your loss. That puts everything else in perspective. But still, I'm very happy to be here. This is my first trip to Nepal since I started as Chief Economist for South Asia this year. And it's my first day on this trip. I will be here the whole week with many meetings. And I see that really as a learning opportunity for me to understand better your challenges and opportunities and to be involved better in the debates. And so I think I can learn a lot more from you than you can learn now at this stage from me. So I hope that this will be very much interactive also. But what I will do is just to start with a couple of observations, first on how I see the global economy and global trends, then a couple of observations on South Asia and what is happening there, and then that becomes very tricky for me, a couple of observations on Nepal from an outsider. So first, the global economy. The last 10 years, the world has become a very different place. And that is because after a global crisis, so in this case, the crisis of 2008, the world is never the same again. And we used to call that the new normal after the crisis. But that happens always when you have a big crisis. And what happens after a crisis like that is that, first of all, there is worldwide an enormous anxiety that results in political changes also, because people are uncertain. They cannot continue to grow and to be part of an economy as it was in the boom before the crisis. They have to change. So very quickly on South Asia, first of all, we have seen a decade now where South Asia was the fastest growing region in the world, especially because of India and Bangladesh, but now recently also because of Nepal, with growth rates that are even higher than the growth rates of China at the moment. So that is an example of that shift of economic power towards Asia. For me, it is not guaranteed in South Asia that that strong growth that we have seen now for a number of years can easily be continued if you are not further integrating into global markets. I am personally very optimistic about the environment you're in, the opportunities you have, but I'm not optimistic yet about the realization. And I would like to see, not just from the government, but also from the private sector, from the students that are graduating from university, that relentless focus on that you need exports to develop. Thank you.
Thank you, Hans. Now that was a great setting of stage. And I think we'll just ensure that we can bring in some questions. So do start thinking of the questions. I have a couple of them to start off with. And I think Hans, in one of the blogs you put up, on your theme about what's behind South Asia's low exports, you talked about, the example of a barber, and the haircut, and talking about a bit more about productivity. I know you touched upon a lot of stuff on the report, but maybe this discourse around productivity is something that is not much happening in Nepal. So maybe you just want to elaborate on that on a bit more on the issue of productivity.
We had many studies that showed that not only exports by itself, they create that increase in knowledge, but you have even more benefits when you export to countries that themselves are very integrated into the world economy. And that shows indeed that that knowledge sharing part is incredibly important. So that's one line of thinking. The other line of thinking is much more traditional, and that has to do with the barber. What you see is that the differences in productivities between countries are very large in what we call the tradable sector. Countries are poor because they have low productivity in tradable goods. When you compare productivity in the non-tradable goods, like the haircut, then those differences are not very big.
One of the discussions, since we are working around those areas, what we see is that on one hand, like for instance with India, we have a bilateral agreement. And then, you know, sort of, but then we talk about low integration within the region, and then we think that, you know, sort of multilateral agreements may be the way out. So what have been some of the learning, some other regions, countries that we can bring into the region to say that, I mean, how does both the bilateral and the multilateral can work, you know, hand in hand? Or what are some of the thoughts on this issue, Hans?
So first on the multilateral part, I think that shift of economic power in the world towards Asia gives a responsibility for Asia to become the champion of free trade, to become the champion of global integration, and to start providing, from your own Asian perspective, global public goods. You cannot develop without that integration into global markets. It just won't happen. And that is what the US realized, that is what earlier the United Kingdom realized, and Asia is realizing that now. If you look at China, then you see that shift already happening. My personal point, but I can be wrong, is that given all these problems, I wouldn't focus completely on regional integration. I think what is important is that you focus on integration in the whole of Asia. So for Nepal, not just India, but also China, there are opportunities for Sri Lanka to directly integrate more into East Asia. And when we looked at the numbers of how South Asia is underperforming, it was not just underperforming in regional trade. It's underperforming there also. But it's basically underperforming in every single market in the world. And so there are lots of opportunities to integrate into others. And if that is through bilateral agreements, so be it. That's very good.
Thanks. I think just moving from south to north, I mean, looking at China, and it's, you know, as we look at trade and what's happening globally also, you know, where do you see, you know, I mean, we were discussing about, you know, I mean, whether we were discussing about how China, was it that they got the entire world on a platter, or is it because this was something that they're working hard on for many years? And how do you see this evolving over a period of time? Because for Nepal, you know, being land linked to China, you know, it has its opportunities also as well as challenges.
No, I think the shift of economic power towards China, that was in the making for a long time. And I think the global financial crisis and the policies in high income countries and the anxiety and the populism that it has generated is only accelerating that. So partly it was China that was very successful after 2008 to keep their economy going. They wanted to change even more than we could think of, because they realized that what had driven the growth in the past was not good enough for the next level of development. And that is true for every country. That is true for Nepal at the moment, although at a different stage. But if you want to reach a higher level, you really have to rethink your policies.
My question is the trade war between US and China, how it will impact to the global growth, and where it will go? How do you think that, how long that it will be worsened, or it will be somehow addressed? So that's what will be in your view? Thank you.
We have got the news that US is withdrawing the GSP facilities, generalized system of preferences facilities, to India beginning day after tomorrow, from Wednesday. So I think this reversing trade scenario in the global trade, what will be the implication to the countries, poor countries, and of course vulnerable countries like Nepal?
So you, as an Western economist, an outsider to our economy, I want to hear your view about fixed exchange rate regime in our country. What effect does it have in export? Doesn't it decrease the incentive to the people who are exporting?
So as there is a growing concern or growing argument that trade deficit is usually responsible for the unemployment, So in this case, how do you view this uncanny statement that huge trade deficit is responsible for big unemployment rate?
If I were to compare the productivity gap of a driver, let's say in Nepal or India, with that of an Uber driver in the US, their productivity gap cannot be as wide as 10 or 15%, whereas their wages in proportion are. I'd like to know what you think about that. Thank you.
First, the trade war. As you said, US-China, now the threat US-Mexico, new developments in US-India, and don't forget about US-Europe and cars also. First, on a positive note, the direct impact on small other countries is not necessarily negative, because you can actually create trade diversion. Trade policies are always complicated. There are always winners and there are always losers. And in the very short run, the smaller countries could be winners. In the long run, everybody is a loser. And the current dynamics are dangerous. So that requires a lot of diplomacy, I think, to prevent the worst. The fixed exchange rate, is that a problem for Nepal? And is that the reason why you can't export? I'm very pragmatic about exchange rate regime. It depends very much on the circumstances. My gut feeling is, my guess is, that that's not the problem for Nepal at the moment. Then if the trade deficit and perhaps even the twin deficits are responsible for unemployment, I'm not sure. I don't know how that would work. The idea is that a trade deficit means a lot of imports, and if you would not import it, then you could have produced it yourself and then you would have created jobs. I think the causality goes the other way around. I would more argue that the fact that you have a trade deficit means that you consume and demand more than you produce, and that's where the problem is. Uber drivers and wage differentials and productivity differentials, if I understood the question correctly, is that the productivity differential between Uber drivers in South Asia and in the United States is not that big, and the wage differentials are huge. So that's exactly the barber story. That's how development works. And that is what the Uber driver is not because of low productivity in the non-tradable sector. It is because of low productivity in the tradable sector.
Thank you. As we go into the next batch of couple of questions, I've got one that has come to, was sent to me to on FDI and foreign direct investments and reforms and its relationship with exports and, you know, lowering of trade deficits. So how do you see the relationship on this?
That shows how connected everything is. So if you are underperforming in exports, it is not just because of tariffs or direct trade policies. It has to do a lot with other things also. And one issue is that there's hardly any foreign direct investment in Nepal. I think it's less than 0.2% of GDP. The other one is more or less linked to FDI, but that is linked to the diaspora and the remittances.
Thank you. So if you have any more questions, we can take a few.
What do you think about, you know, Nepal right now thinking about these kinds of policies? Is it the kind of laws or policies that we need to be spending our energies in right now or ever? Why so and why not so? So basically about, you know, what do you think about, you know, these anti-dumping and countervailing duty laws?
What are some other peculiar characters of South Asian economy, and what are the strengths of Southeast Asian economy?
How would a country like Nepal, while assimilating into the new economic paradigm, perhaps ensure a more sustainable approach to development?
So I don't know the details of the anti-dumping policies that are in the making. Sometimes there might be a reason to go after anti-dumping, but in general, let me emphasize again that In my view, importers and higher importers, they don't solve a current account deficit, and they actually bring the exports down also. So what is another characteristic for South Asia, and is there also a strength of South Asia? Let me try that one. I think where South Asia is very special is the incredibly large size of an informal economy. And you don't see that in many other parts of the world. The formal economy works now in South Asia is not something that has to be expanded, because there are huge problems in the formal economy. So when we look at the more advanced economies, one of the big reversals that these technologies are bringing is that we see a shift from formal employment to informal employment. Trade-off between high growth and sustainable development. In the very short run, perhaps, yes. In the long run, obviously, no. And I think South Asia is the perfect example of that. When you think about sustainable development, you think about sustainable energy.
Thank you. I think any final words before we close? Any takeaways? I think there's been lots of things, and I don't want to summarize, but I really loved your stuff on informal economy as the future coming up. And any final words, remarks you had have before we close?
No, I have one final question, and that is linked to that. And also because I actually want to learn. But I think there are a couple of students here. And so I want to know who of you are thinking of starting your own small company. So one of you who want to start a company, what do you think are the opportunities and the problems in Nepal that you are facing it? So I give one of you the last word.
We started this company to identify potential products for exports from Nepal. It's a 6-month-old company. While exporting, the market is ready with the products in Nepal. The technology in Nepal is not ready. So this is a major problem. The government is not supporting the way it should support the farmers. When we look at the global market, we see 100 companies from entire South Asia goes, they exhibit their products from Nepal. It's hardly one or two companies. So why? And how can World Bank help us?
So
overcoming this
that's
problem.
A good way to end it.
So that's a perfect last word. There's work to be done.
Thank you. So a big round of applause for Hans Timmer. Thank you. Thank you, Hans, for taking your time to come and be part of NEF Talk. Thank you all for being here. With that, we'll just come to a close. Thank you very much to the Bead Knowledge Center and the team to put this NEF Talk together, and Himalaya Hotel, our preferred hotel always. Thank you very much.